if you've been snorkeling or swimming in the ocean, if you've been to tide pools, if you've been scuba diving, there were nudibranchs there, I can guarantee it. Think of the slugs in your garden. That's what they're closely related to, but they don't look anything like that in so many ways. I think their color patterns are honestly what drew me to them the most. There are some nudibranchs that are as long as the thickness of your fingernail, and there are some as large as, you know, a foot or so in length. Some can supposedly get to be larger, but I've never seen any of those. The diversity of sizes in addition to their shapes and colors, that's part of what makes it a really interesting group to study. Hello, I'm Dr. Jessica Goodheart. I am the assistant curator for mollusks in the Division of Invertebrate Zoology, and here we are in the Invertebrate Zoology Wet Collections. Malacology is the study of mollusks. You can think of things like cephalopods, which are octopus and squid, bivalves like clams, mussels, and snails and slugs like you might find in your garden. Nudibranchs are a kind of sea slug. All nudibranchs are sea slugs, but not all sea slugs are nudibranchs. I can tell you for sure that I know when I first saw a sea slug in the wild, and that's because my mom has a picture of it when I was, I don't know, maybe in third grade or something like that. I grew up in California. We did a class trip to tide pools, and I was holding this giant sea slug, that California sea hare, which can be quite heavy. I can't remember the exact first time I found a nudibranch, but I know it was docking. So docking is where we just go to like floating docks and look on the sides. And if you look down, you can see a lot of things growing, like algae and hydroids and a lot of things like that. And often you'll just see nudibranchs in there. And I do remember the feeling of sort of flipping over a piece of algae and seeing one on it. And sort of that, like, that excitement that came from actually seeing it in the wild. That was pretty incredible, actually. They're worldwide in the Arctic, tropics, Antarctic, anywhere in between. And then you'll find them in incredibly shallow areas like tide pools, high tide, all the way down to the deep sea. We estimate that there's right now around 3,000 described species of nudibranchs, but there could be upwards of 6,000 to 10,000 species based on sort of what we know about the world and how many we found that haven't been described yet. And for context, that's about how many bird species there are, right? There's about 10,000 species of birds. And I think people would probably agree that birds are quite important in terms of the ecosystems and our understanding about the environment. And sea slugs would be the same as well. They're primarily carnivores, so they'll eat things like cnidarians, like hydroids, anemones, jellyfish. Others eat sponges or bryozoans. There's at least one nudibranch group that actually eats other nudibranchs. One of the features of nudibranchs is that they actually have shells as larvae, and then when they metamorphose into juvenile stage, they lose those shells. And so they've actually evolved a number of ways to defend themselves. Some steal chemicals from their prey. Some have bright colors along with those chemicals to sort of tell predators like, hey, no, don't eat me, I'm toxic. Some actually are cryptic, so they sort of hide within the thing that they feed on. And others sort of have evolved other mechanisms like stealing stinging structures from their prey. And this is in particular ones that eat cnidarians, things like anemones, jellyfish, hydroids. If you've been stung by a jellyfish, that sting comes from specialized defensive structures that it has in its cells. Nudibranchs are able to sort of eat those animals and take those defenses from them in order to use them themselves. In my lab, I study how they're able to actually do this process at a molecular level. Nudibranchs are in here. So this is actually the Glaucus atlanticus. This is one of the more interesting ones when it's preserved. We have a couple hundred nudibranch specimens here at the museum. One of the downsides to working on nudibranchs is that unfortunately they lose their color when we preserve them. So they don't look quite as exciting in the collection as they do in real life. We do ultimately try to use one specimen for as many things as possible. If we collect a specimen, we might try and take a tissue sample for genetic analysis later. This could include freezing it or putting it in ethanol. Even if we're not able to, at the time, think about what questions we might ask, we would have those specimens for later. having these collections is incredibly useful for being able to sort of continuously ask questions, even when we're not able to continuously collect animals. It can be overwhelming even at times, seeing or thinking about how many questions there are to ask, how much there is to do, how much we don't know, but that's part of what's exciting about being a biologist.